Hey, everybody. Minds up, everyone. Whatever you're feeling right now, it's a beautiful day outside, and I hope you guys are enjoying yourself. Because today, as she says, we're going to shake off your money blues.
Hello, everybody. Hello.
Today, you guys are going to lose all of that. But you guys know how it goes down. Before we start, we take a couple minutes and we feel good and we raise our vibration. So let's take our 35 seconds to just shake it off. Whatever it is that you're feeling, thinking, I don't know and I don't care, but shake it off, because right now we are getting prepared to have a lovely, lovely guest who's going to help you lose your money blues. Okay, let's go. All right. Shake it off, everybody. Woo! But I keep cruising, can't stop, won't start grooving. It's like I got this music. Get on my vibe, saying it's gonna be alright. It's gonna be alright.
Exactly, the girl got it right.
Shake it off, shake it off, shake it off, shake it off. Whoa! Shake it off, shake. Where are my sexy people at? Shake it off the money for you guys. Come on. Yeah. Go, Tanya. Go, Tanya. Go, Tanya. Go. Yes. Hey,
over there with the hella good hair. Won't you come on
over, baby? We can shake. We can shake. All right. Are you guys ready? I hope you guys are feeling good. It is a beautiful Monday. It's Monday morning for me. It's Monday evening for Tanya.
It is indeed. Yes, my day is nearly finished.
But wherever you are in the world, we want to thank you so much for just, you know, taking the time out to come and spend this moment with us. So, first of all, I would like to welcome you all to the Enlightenpreneur Blab Show. And this is the place where world changers impact lives by helping other leaders lead, heal, and love. Now, if this is your first time coming into Blab with me, I want to thank you for tuning in. Out of any other Blab out there in Blab world, you chose me, and that means more to me than anything. Now, my name is Takiya Diamond. And some of you know me, some of you don't, but if you tuned into this Blab, you'll see I'm very easy to love. I want to, you know, again, just welcome you guys. I am the author of the Minds Up Personal Development book series, Get Your Life Together, Wisdom Words of Consciousness, and 7 Things You Need to Change Your Life. I am also a motivation and transformational speaker, as well as a mindset and accountability coach. My expertise and passion is showing you the mind trash, okay, that has held you hostage. And so what I have done is I have created this platform to bring you guys people who are on the same path as I am, but have an additional unique gift that can really help you transform your life. Now, I want to say this. Tonight, I'm your host. So don't expect me to be reading no books or anything like that, okay? Now, if you were attracted to this show, chances are you are already enlightened in some way, or you're either on the path seeking to take your gift to the next step if you're not on the path already. Either way, you have arrived at the perfect place at the perfect time. And you're more than likely, if this is your first time, here with me, then more than likely, you're probably on your way into the enlightened path, and you were kind of guided here to get some really helpful information and to have an opportunity to be assisted by one of the chosen ones who has answered the call to follow their path and come here and support you and assist you with your purpose. So again, I created this platform for like-minded individuals who are actually seeking solutions to help them become the change they wish to see in the world. So we're all here on purpose, and the purpose of Minds Up, the Enlightenpreneur Show, is so that you no longer have to live by default, because I am bringing you the help where you can actually go ahead and choose. All right. Now, are you ready to lose your money blues? I hope so, because the guest that I have online on Blab with you guys today, she says, when life knocks you down, flourish wherever you land. That means no excuses. It does not matter where you came from. All that matters is where you are right now, when what you do with what you have, with where you are. So you can start right here, all jacked up. Yep, you can start right here. And if you're already all good, you can still start right here to become even greater than you already are. So I want you guys to meet Tanya Angeles. Am I saying your name right, honey?
You are indeed, lovely. Yes.
Yes, 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 yes. And just real briefly, let me see. I'm trying to think which way that I want to go with that. But you know what, though? Let me introduce you, and then I'll allow you to share a little bit more.
No worries.
All right. Well, Tanya is an EFT tapping practitioner and a money confidence coach. And I know some of you guys need a lot more confidence. I don't even say a little more confidence, a lot more confidence when it comes to money, because those little naggy things be all in the way. But Tanya does a fabulous job of helping you get rid of all of that sticky stuff that you feel when you're trying to call that money to you. Now, Tanya specializes in helping you blend spirituality with practicality to achieve prosperous living. And I don't know anybody who doesn't want to live a prosperous life. If that sounds like you, like you're somebody who don't want to live a prosperous life, then this is probably not the show for you today. Now, she's had her challenges, like many of us, with financial abundance, and she learned to feel better about money, which changed everything. Now she teaches other women to do the same. Now, guys, don't freak out. Tanya does help men too. It just seems sometimes that women are a little more susceptible to change than guys. Okay, that's a stereotype, but I'm just saying. So, Tanya Angeles, she began her personal spiritual journey as a trained crystal healer, actually, with the International Association of Crystal Healing and other therapists. So I think this was like an organization that she was a part of where she mastered this skill of how to really, you know, go ahead and do the whole crystal thing. Now, over time, she actually added Reiki, holistic healing for horses. See, so she don't help just humans. She also loves the animals as well. Therapeutic massage, angel card readings, angel therapy, and tapping, EFT. Have to add that to the bum. Okay. Now, she works with both people and animals, either on a one-on-one basis or to teach them how to use these therapies for themselves. So I'm so glad that you guys are tuned in today to hear this Enlightenpreneur show you how to tap away your money blues to grow your business.
Well, that was the best intro I've ever had. Thank you so much, Takiya.
Welcome. And you already know, you know, this is what it's about. It's about making sure that everyone knows exactly who you are, what it is you do, so that they can understand that there is help available. So I'm going to ask everybody to clap your hands. And I know you guys know this song, so get excited.
Everybody, let's snap, snap, snap. Everybody, let's tap,
tap, tap, tap.
Yeah, let's sing it. Clap, clap, clap.
Clap your hands, clap your hands. Clap your hands. Just like me. Touch your shoulders, touch your shoulders. Touch them just like me. Clap your knees,
clap your hands like me. All right, so yeah, I know I always have to bring out the child in you because sometimes we just get so serious.
I know, being a grown up isn't always that fun.
So welcome, lovely, lovely. Oh my God, Tanya, thank you so much for showing up today.
You're very welcome. And as we were talking, as you mentioned, angel cards and oracle cards, as we were getting ready for the show, I asked for some cards, and I used one of my favorite decks, which is Doreen Virtue's Mermaids and Dolphins. Yeah. And this is the card that they pulled out for me for everybody tonight, which is this one.
Make a wish. Okay, I got this.
And the little message at the bottom says, this is a magical moment. Make a wish and enjoy its manifestation. Woo-hoo-hoo! And then tucked in just behind it was this card, which says, watch your thoughts. It's important to think only about what you desire, not what you fear. So that's another wish card. So everybody, you've got a double wish. On 222, it's loads and loads of double numbers today. So yeah. I hope you've now made a wish and that you can see it coming through. And then what you got to do is you then got to focus on that wish until it becomes a reality. Because the difference between a wish and a dream, and there's one difference between the two. A wish is something that you don't do anything about. A dream is something you take action towards achieving. And for me, it's been a long-held dream to be able to work as a coach. I've always had this vision of myself working as a coach, but working on what they call a one-to-many basis, where I work with loads and loads of people. When I was very early on in my spiritual path, one of the visions that I kept being given was me standing up on a stage in front of everybody, and there was this huge audience, you know, sort of a bit like one of these huge conference centers that people go, people like Tony Robbins, where there's like, you know, people just disappear off into the distance. Well, there was me standing on this stage talking to all these people. And now about 10 or so years later, that vision is now starting to come true, where not necessarily on a physical stage, but I'm here, I'm on a virtual stage now, and I'm reaching so many more people than I ever dreamed possible. But I mean, and what I want to share with you is that the reason I've been drawn to do this work is, yes, I have struggled so much with money, and there are thousands and thousands of people in the world who are also struggling with money. And it can be one of the loneliest things in the world to be not be able to cope with your money. And what I've learned to do, and what I've, all my teaching programs I've created, these are all the tools that I wished I could have had when I was going through my money hell. And so many times I looked around and I just thought, I wish there was someone I could just reach out to on a human basis that is affordable and reachable, because there's so many people out there who are teaching about money, and then you look at it and you go, I can't afford that.
Right.
So I knew I had to do something about it. And so I have really kept my programs to the point where they are easily affordable. And I also make sure that I also provide lots and lots of genuine free resources, because you see an awful lot of people and they offer, and they say, oh, yes, we've got all these free things. And when you look at it, there's very little of any value to it. You know, there's no real how do I get this? There's no step-by-step things. And that's what all of my things are about. So I have guided meditations on my website. I have a free ebook that people can download. I have all sorts of things on there that people can have for free.
Yes, that's so awesome. Get to that part because you're going to share all of that with them.
I will. But that was one of my drivers. Was it needs to be, this information needs to be given out, and I am more than happy to share it on a free basis, like we're doing here. And yes, then for my private clients, we dive in really deep. We go into their personal story. So what I do here is general and kind of across the board. But then when we work on a one-to-one basis, we dive into their story. We find out what their fears are. Because every person I work with, they come to me worried about money. And everyone has a different story, and everyone has a different starting point, and everyone has a different place that they want to get to.
Right.
So, and it's just amazing, you know, the different stories that you hear. And that's one of the reasons why I love what I do. So
awesome. Well, we are definitely going to get to, you know, the stories that people tell you and all of that. And I just want to, you know, give you a hand clap, you know, for sure.
Thank you.
Because it takes a lot of courage to actually step to the plate, you know, knowing that in some way, when you first come into this transition, that people may judge you, or people may think that you're weird, or people may think like, oh, you know, that's not possible. But you have shown people that it is possible. And what I would like for you to do is, we all know that there are so many different beliefs that people are attached to that keep their money woes alive. What was your financial story like before you transitioned your money downers into money uppers?
Well, my story has always been one of struggle, of lack, of lurching from crisis to crisis, of barely struggling from one paycheck to the next, or one benefits check to the next. My money story caused, you know, broken relationships. All kinds of huge, really powerful, difficult transitions. And it got to a point in 2008 where I had to declare bankruptcy. I couldn't see a way out, and I just didn't know what to do with this mountain of debt. And I was also doing something which a lot of women do as entrepreneurs, and I was seriously under earning. Mm-hmm. So that is a, you know, it's a lot of people end up in money difficulties, not because they're overspending, but simply that they're not earning enough. And they're not necessarily, you know, in tens of thousands of pounds of credit card debt and all the rest. They simply haven't quite got enough to get them the basics that they need to pay their bills, to buy their food and so on. And for many, many people, week in, week out, it's a choice. Do I pay this bill and keep the lights on, or do I spend that money on food for my children? And it can be as painful as that. And for me, that's the situation that I found myself in. So when I was declared bankrupt, at the time I had a limited company. So I had to step away from my limited company and go back into self-employment as a sole trader. So and bankruptcy then puts a lot of restrictions on you. And it also means that every time you fill in any kind of financial form, even insurance forms, you have to say that you have been, that you were once bankrupt. It follows you for the rest of your life.
Wow.
And it's really painful to go through. So I went through that really difficult phase. And a few years later, so that was at the start of the sort of the big recession. I managed to trade my way through most of the recession. And then when we got to 2011, my business was starting to really dry up, and I just got to a point where I had to close the business.
Right.
So I again ended up in a place with, well, this time I had no business. And because I had to close my business and the income therefore disappeared completely, my then husband chose that time to walk out on me. Mm-hmm. So there I am, no business, no money, owing a lot of money on our mortgage on our home. He left.
Right.
So then I obviously, the mortgage company wanted the house back. So eventually that came to pass that they got their mortgage, that they got the house back. So I lost my home. I also, at that time, I tried to find alternative employment, found something that I thought was brilliant.
Right.
Turned out I ended up getting severely bullied by the MD and then had to then take them to court over what happened. Right. So I had a huge period of really deep stress in my life at that time, and I ended up losing everything because it was also the time that my two youngest children finally left home. So I had no children at home, so I had an empty nest which was I didn't know it was going to be taken away from me at some point.
Right.
So I was just, you know, I now call it a total life reset. Everything that I knew was taken away from me. And when you end up in those places, you can end up really badly broken. So I broke in here. Right. I really broke inside. You know, my heart broke, my mind broke, everything. So I ended up at that place where there is nothing to do but climb out of the pit.
Mm.
And it took me a while. And, you know, and I had to do it step by step by step.
Right.
And if it wasn't for the help of my angels, I don't know if I would have actually got out of that step. And in many ways, that what they call the dark night of the soul, or Mastin Kip calls it the divine storm. You know, when you have this sort of like huge falling away of everything in your life.
Yes.
It leaves you with nothing except your faith to hold together. And even that I started doubting. And I just said one day, am I even talking to angels?
Right.
And I got to the point where I really did doubt it. And later that day, I had to go into the supermarket, which was really quite challenging for me at the time because they can be very overwhelming when you're really stressed.
Yes.
And then I literally felt someone pinch my ear, and this voice went, listen. And I listened to the radio that was on in the store. And there was a song playing, and it was Annie Lennox singing "Must Be Talking to an Angel." That was my cue to say, "You can climb up now, girl." Yeah. And I was like, "Wow, okay." So I'm now going to believe that my angels are real, and I can now look at and follow their guidance.
Yeah.
And so I gradually followed their guidance and climbed out of the hole. They guided me to become more creative. So I found a dressmaking course. Now, the only thing with being an entrepreneur is that you never stop being an entrepreneur, even if when you're learning. So I found I had a talent for doing the dressmaking. So I then tried to turn that into a little business.
Okay.
And so I got funding for that business, and I started, and I actually got myself a place at Liverpool Fashion Week on opening night.
Wow.
So I had to design and make 24 outfits, which were then showcased to the world,
nice.
To the whole of the fashion world. It was like, wow. And I got so much publicity, and, you know, it was like, whoa, I was on TV, I was on blogging platforms, I was on the radio. It was like, whoa, this is brilliant.
Exciting.
And do you know what came out of all that? Nothing. Not a single sale, nothing. But what I also discovered at this time was that money that I borrowed to set up the business, I ran through that like water. And I nearly ended up having to go down the bankruptcy route again. And that's the point at which I thought, I have got to do something about this. That I have done the same thing over and over again. There must be something that I am overlooking. Yeah. And that's when my angels brought me back to my EFT. Now, I learned EFT back in 2001, 2002.
Okay.
And I learned what I call the classical EFT, which is where you use all the meridian points in the fingers or some of the fingers. You do movements with the eyes it's all very complicated. I found the whole thing. It was like, oh my God, this is just like irritating.
Right.
And so I just like pushed it to one side and thought, this is irritating, because one of the things I really can't stand is when somebody comes up to you and just tap, and you're like, stop doing that with me. It really annoys me. So I got guided back into doing my tapping. So I found myself listening to the lovely Nick Ortner, who does the Tapping World Summit, which actually is starting today as well, a few hours' time. This year's one is absolutely brilliant. So I started listening to that, and I really started to experiment with my tapping. And I found that it started opening up my mind to all of the things and the thoughts I had about money, which were making money just vanish out of my life.
Wow.
And it was like, it was a total revelation. I went through a really deep, intense one-to-one training through my angels using my EFT for about 8 or 9 months. And it just cleared and cleared and cleared so much stuff. And then towards the end of that time, I could feel myself being pushed very firmly that you need to start teaching this. And I was like, I can't teach this. This is too scary, you know, and my angels have guided me so many times to push me into teaching, you know. It's like, I thought, I can't, you know, when I first started getting in touch with angels, I started teaching at Mind, Body, Spirits and helped to connect people to their guardian angels and so on. But I found the whole thing was somewhat overwhelming, you know, and I couldn't cope with it at the time. So I pulled away from it, and I was finding myself trying to do the same again. It was like, you know, oh, I don't know if I can do this. And
right.
And what my angels told me and showed me very clearly was the things that we struggle with the most in this life, the things that we really find the most challenging, are what we are here to teach. And I had two things that I struggled with. One's money and the other is relationships. Mm. And I just thought, I really don't want to teach about relationships. I really don't want to go down that road. So that left me with teaching about money. And then that's when you start, that's when your ego mind, your monkey mind starts playing, you know, who's going to want to listen to someone who was declared bankrupt? How can someone who was declared bankrupt talk about money?
Right.
You know, and then it was like, well, you've not exactly got a multi-million dollar business. How on earth are you going to teach people about money? Are you going to, and it was all of these things, because when you start being drawn to teaching, you start looking around for people who are a little further ahead of you in your field, not necessarily your subject, but in your field. So as I was, I've always been a coach. I've always done coaching and I've always done sort of mentoring and things like that and teaching. You know, at my core, I am a teacher, no matter what form it takes.
Right.
And so when you start saying this, like, oh, well, follow me because I can help you create a six-figure business, and follow me because I can help you make a seven-figure business, and follow me because, you know, I've done all this, and follow me because look at this gorgeous light, you know, all these billowing white curtains and all this sea breezes, and look, this is this luxury house that I've created. And it's like, there you are, barely able to pay your rent and your electric and wonder if you've got enough food for the week. And you look at it's like the earth versus the moon. It's like so far away from where you are. You cannot wrap your head around it. So I was trying to find people who were closer to my level, and I just couldn't find anybody. So I realized that was the gap that I was being asked to step into, was to help those. So I gradually found people that I felt able to relate to. And I learned a lot from them. And then I then sort of started creating my own platform, my own stories and so on. So I started very quietly by writing. And it was during my sort of recovery as I was sort of moving into the more creative side. And I did start writing about angels. I set up a little tiny angel blog. And I think it was my second article, somebody who was, because I knew nothing about blogging, somebody who was a massive angel blogger, she found it and she retweeted or reposted it to all of her followers. All of a sudden I had 200 people on my little blog and I was like, oh my God, this is, and it scared the bejesus out of me. I was like, oh my God, this is too much. So again, I shut down. It was like, no, I can't do this. I can't do this. So my angels had to very patiently work with me to help me build up my confidence. Mm. And as I really cleared everything through my EFT, it built up my confidence. It built up my voice. It enabled me to really start saying, okay, I'm going to teach about this.
Nice.
And I thought, well, what can I do that is different, that is around the topic of money, but isn't around financial freedom or isn't around six-figure businesses or isn't.
Right.
And I just thought, well, the thing that people need the help the most with, because every money book you read will tell you the same, is you have to learn to master your mind when it comes to money. And well, not just money, but every aspect of your life.
Everything.
So when you learn to really master your emotions and how you think and how you feel, right, your life just blossoms.
Yes.
And it blossoms in ways that you cannot predict when you start the whole process. It guides you to the most amazing people, the amazing circumstances and situations. So, and it's, you know, it's brought us together. It's brought all the people who are listening to us together. And yes, it's just the most amazing thing that you can do for yourself is learn to love yourself, but most of all, to learn to manage your own emotions, how you feel, because how you feel about everything is everything.
Yeah.
And it doesn't matter what the topic is, how you feel about it is one. There's a lovely saying, which is how you do one thing is how you do everything. And it's the same with your emotions. How you feel about one thing in your life is how you feel about everything in your life. And if you have one topic like money that is really haunting you,
yes,
if you're honest and you look around at the other areas like relationships, like your health, like your spiritual life, you will find that there are also areas where those parts of your life are also in deep poverty as well, where your spirituality isn't as high as it could be, where you're maybe struggling health-wise, and it just seems like no matter how much you try and improve your health, it seems to get worse and worse. And all of this is all related to how we think and feel in our mind, in our heart, in every, you know, so inside. So I ended up, as I say, in a place where I was so dark, I was looking for a way out. I was actively looking for a way out. And fortunately for the world, I'm not that brave and I don't like physical pain. So I was restricted in my choices as to how I could leave the planet. And as I had no access to anything other than my angels, I was saved and I was brought back to help people here.
Yes.
So I know how hard it is to pull yourself out of a dark space, but it can be done. All you need is patience with yourself, patience with the process, and a cast iron determination that you are going to rise again. So there's two acronyms for the word fear, which is false evidence appearing real, but the one I love is face everything and rise. And that I took as my motto is like, yes. So
yes,
when we learn to face into those things that scare us the most, it actually turns out it's what I call the Dorothy moment. You remember at the end of The Wizard of Oz, where they finally make it into the wizard's castle at the end.
Right.
And then they see the great big face of Oz there, this great big, and this booming voice.
Right.
And what does little Toto do? He goes and pulls the curtain back, and behind the curtain, there's this little man.
And
the big scary voice goes, take no notice of that little man behind the curtain.
Well, you know, even with you saying that, I want to share with our listeners and say hi to Regina because she's tuned in. Say hi, Regina.
Hi, Regina.
Oh, even with that, that greatly signifies your ego self. It has this big voice that tells you all of these things, and it acts so macho. You cannot accomplish that. You'll never be financially stable. You filed bankruptcy. Oh, you don't have money to go on vacation. And it's really this little thing that we give this big power just because of the way that it comes at us. And we believe it because the illusion of it is that it's so much bigger than you. But you are so much bigger than it. And once you step
absolutely
up, like Tanya just said, once you just step up and be courageous and just say, I'm not listening to that anymore. I know what I want to accomplish, and I'm going to go forth and get it done. You step into that power. Try it on. Step on that person. Step into that person of who you really are. So the little man behind the wall can, you know, maybe Toto can bite him or something. I don't know.
Exactly. And when you have that kind of reveal moment, you know, when that curtain is pulled back and you realize that what you've been listening to is completely false, is not the real you. That's when you really start to be able to embrace your own power. And when you embrace your own power, your life just flips. Exactly. And you start being able to do things that you only ever thought you might be able to do on a good day. And then all of a sudden, you know, it's was it like advert? Is it for Barocca, those vitamin things? And it says you, but on a good day. And it's like all of a sudden, every day is a good day, and you know, and then you become so much more aware of your thought processes, and you're able to start picking up those little, and when it just those little negative things that just run across, and you go, whoa, hold on a minute, and you go, right back here, what was that? No, that is not how it is. Right, and then that gives you the opportunity to let go of that thought pattern. And once you start doing that, my goodness me, your world just changes in that instance.
Awesome.
You know, the book A Course in Miracles, you know, it says that what a miracle is a change in perception. It's a change in how you see things. And it is, it's absolutely real. That is exactly what a miracle is. Yeah. It's not suddenly turning water into wine. You know, that obviously is, that's a physical change. But a miracle, that happens in here.
Wow.
And it happens in here. And when you start feeling those, that's when your life starts turning around.
I think even that, I think Jesus just kind of had the ability to project that it would be wine, and he was more powerful in his place to believe. So once you trust it, it has to be. It can be no other way, because that's just the laws of the universe. If you understand the laws, then you'll understand how to use your mind, how to channel that you want and call it into you. And speaking of that, after our tapping session, because I have to let it be known, Tanya, you are a phenomenal person. And I have been creating to myself, okay, unexpected checks are going to just show up to me. Money, people will just give me money just because they want to give me money. And, you know, just really just starting to speak that over my life and what I wanted to see. And there was a time when I would say unexpected checks would show up, but in my mind, I don't think I was completely connected to the belief of it. It was like, you can't say you want something and then in your mindset, you're not in alignment with what you say you want, because it won't happen. So I actually just kind of like lined up with it. And my very first unexpected check showed up today. And I was like,
woohoo!
I just made all these appointments. I was like, okay, yeah. So now let me go do this, let me do that. And I was like, because I also remember the laws of money. You have to take that 10% and put it over. And you know, I don't care if it's $2. What if you make 20, take that $2 and put it to the side, because you'll mess up the flow from coming.
Yes.
You don't follow the actual laws of money.
Yeah.
I'm going to do a nice blab on the laws of money and have like you and me, two other people who really know this money mindset. And people come in. So that gets me to our next question. Some people are not aware of the difference between wealth and abundance. So they hear these two terms very often. You know, they hear, oh my God, this guy is really, really wealthy. And then they hear someone else say about themselves, I live an abundant life. But the question is, what's the difference between wealth and abundance? So can you share with our audience what's the difference between wealth and abundance?
So to me, wealth is very much tied up around money. Wealth to me is very much tied up around having more money than you can spend easily, but money that you really love and value. So money that's coming into your life that isn't just supporting you, it's you who are the steward of that money. So it changes the way that you see money. So what will start happening with, as you start changing your money mindset, what you will start finding is that you will start getting small increments of money starting to appear in your life. And you will start making the effort to really start putting things into savings. And you will start building what Anne Wilson calls little wealth pots. So you have little pockets of money around you. When you become truly wealthy, what happens is that you have all these, and these little pots, they fill up easily and then they start overflowing. And you can then start channeling that money into the things that you've always wanted to. And so very often a wealthy person will make sure that their money is being sent out through, for example, charitable donations. Or people like some of the really wealthy ones, they'll be setting up their own charitable trust and things like that, so that their money actually then goes not just to looking after themselves and their family and their immediate community, but looking after the community as a whole. There are so many horror stories around, you know, our newspapers and magazines are just fixated with celebrities making mistakes. And when you read them, there is so much in there that is tied to their money and the mistakes that they're making. So what happens is you start getting all these messages that having lots of money means that you're going to be miserable, or that you've got to break the law, or that you've got to do these really nasty things. And so we have a big job as money coaches to tell people that, you know what, it's okay to be rich, it's okay to be wealthy, because you don't have to be horrible with it. You don't have to spend your time, you know, inhaling illegal substances to have a good time. You don't have to, you know, embarrass yourself with your behavior. You know, you don't have to have the morals of an alley cat just because you've got a huge amount of money. So to me, a wealthy person is someone who has accumulated lots of money, but who has also accumulated a really strong set of values that money must be channeled into the world in order to grow everyone's wealth consciousness so that other people will benefit from it.
Okay.
Now, when we talk about abundance, abundance is everything. It really is looking at every aspect of your life. So abundance goes into your health. So if you've been struggling with your health, you can start working with your energy, with the energy of your mind to start improving your health. If you've been struggling with your money, you can use your abundance consciousness to bring more money to you. If you've been feeling really, if your faith has been lacking or has dropped, you can use abundance to increase your faith. You can use it and you can use it to grow your business. You can use it to grow your friendships. You can use it to heal relationships. You can use it to bring your family together. So abundance is something that is everywhere. So it's like God. There is nowhere that abundance isn't, except that we have this little voice in here that says, there's no, that bit. Oh, abundance is everywhere, but not in this bit.
Right.
So we're okay with that. Yes, we don't mind having, we're okay if we have really rich relationships. That's great. but we can't have really rich relationships and great health all at the same time. That's not allowed. Wow. So that is where the difference is between wealth and abundance, at least in my book. So when you actually start, and one of the great tools that I've found to help grow your feelings of abundance in every part of your life is a meditation technique which I learned a few months ago called Japa meditation. Mm-hmm. And I learned it from the late, great Wayne Dyer. Oh, my hero. I found it.
It's called Japa meditation,
J-A-P-A.
Oh, Japa meditation.
Japa meditation, yes. Thank
you. Welcome for coming.
And the Japa meditation, there is a free YouTube video of a Japa meditation by Wayne Dyer. So if you just hop into YouTube and just type in Wayne Dyer Japa meditation, you'll find it, a lovely 20-minute one. So I heard him talk about it in a couple of his books. And I just went onto YouTube just out of curiosity. And I started working with the Japa meditation. Mm-hmm. And what Japa meditation does is it works with some of the ancient Sanskrit sounds of creation. And it works in the morning with the sound of ah. And in the evening, it works with the sound of om. So it works with those two sounds.
Okay.
So I particularly, as I'm a morning person, I'm not much of an evening person. I tend to work. Oh, evening, peel. So in the mornings I work with, and it's a vocal meditation as well. So if you've ever wanted to try meditation, but you have a really busy mind that won't shut up and you're sitting there and you're going, this isn't working and I'm supposed to be relaxed and I'm supposed to be, this is supposed to be good for me and I'm getting more and more stressed trying to relax. This is where you find that the Japa meditation is amazing because it actually trains you to overcome your mind because you actually have something to do with your body.
Right.
So it's a vocal. So we sound it out. We go, ah. Mm-hmm. And you do that for about 20 minutes and you can literally any part of your life you can use the Japa meditation for. And I couldn't believe how quickly, within 2 days of starting to use it, my life started really opening up.
Wow.
And I was like, oh my God. And I found that my connection to spirit really increased. My psychic skills really increased. My clairaudience became so much clearer. My clairvoyance became so much stronger. My clairsentience became so much more powerful. Then my claircognizance, it was like boom, boom, boom. It's like, whoa.
Right, right.
And if you ever combine doing the Japa meditation with a soak in the bath, wow, that is amazing. Because the water picks up the vibrations of the sound as well. And it's like, whoa. So you're like in a complete bath. You're literally soaking in sound. It's amazing.
Okay.
And it really opens up every aspect of your life, including your finances.
Awesome.
So just be, you know, so if you've got some little dreams that you've had.
I want you to type in Wayne Dyer and the correct spelling.
Oh, sure. There we go. Right. So it's Wayne Dyer.
Thanks
and
you.
It's Japa meditation. Jacob, sit down. Sorry, that's my dog, Jacob. He's a bit hot, aren't you? Right.
Okay,
there we go. Hello everybody. I've been so busy talking into the webcam. I've not been taking any notice of what's been going on down the side. So I'm so sorry.
Okay. So I mean, I definitely applaud you on that and thank you for sharing that information with us about the whole Japa meditation. Wayne Dyer was one of the first people that I stumbled across when I first came into the awakening.
And he's done that for so many people.
My medication. It was like Wayne Dyer every morning. I just needed my dose.
Yes.
But it assisted me so much in becoming and knowing that there was so much more to me than what I was even recognizing. And I think one of the greatest people who really, really touched me in switching, turning on my mindset and me becoming an author and a coach and a speaker coming from the music world, because most people know me for music, like, you know, doing movies and in videos and stuff. And so now they see this chick who used to be out there on some other stuff, and now I'm just on this elegant, like, I still turn up sometimes, but that's on my time, and I can turn up if I want to. but Bob Proctor, and what Bob Proctor said to me in this video that I was watching that changed everything. Oh my God, this was the turning point in my life. In this video, he said, "You have nothing to lose except the life that you live today by trying something different." So whatever I'm telling you to do and try, if it doesn't work, whatever you've been doing all of this time hasn't worked either. So it's not really going to make a difference. If you try this, what I'm telling you, you have nothing to lose. So try it. And if it works, keep doing it. And I said, that makes so much sense. You really don't have anything to lose. People fear trying something new or trying something different because they're not familiar with it. But it's that very unfamiliar thing that you're afraid to try, that part of you doesn't want you to try it because it knows it's going to lose its grip on your mind. It knows it's going to lose its grip, and your behind is going to become prosperous, more mindful of the words that you speak. You're going to have a much more happier life. You're going to be much more humbled. Everything is just going to change, and it doesn't want to lose that rowdiness that it allows to bring into your life, you know? So
yes. Yep, that is true, because that's what I've done with everything that I teach my clients and I teach my groups, is that, you know, if it works, keep doing it. But if something isn't working, then that is your opportunity to say, what is it that needs to be changed here? You know, this, I've tried this and it hasn't worked. I've tried this and it hasn't worked. And when you realize that no matter what you try, it brings you back to the same point, that's when you realize that the thing that needs to change is in here. Mm-hmm. And that was the point that I reached, you know, and say, because time and time and time again, I would find myself in a position where I was broke and I would just, you know, it was like, why does this keep happening? Why does this keep happening? So when I started working and really started clearing, it was just so, my life has just changed so much. Mm. So I am now starting to really live the vision that I have for myself for such a long time that I thought was just a mirage that, you know, it was just put there to tease me. Yeah. I am now living it. It's like, wow. You know, I one of my dreams as a child was to be a writer. I write every single day now. So I write blog articles every day. I've started writing books. I've started writing materials for my courses and so on. So every single day I write. Right. I write all over social media as well, you know, supporting the ladies in my groups. Yeah. You know, so all, it's amazing. When you start seeing all these things, when you really open up your mind to what you can do, because the other thing that your ego will tell you is that you are this big and you are tiny and nobody's interested. Actually, that it's the ego that's little tiny thing, and yeah, the big bit outside, that is you.
Yes.
But because it shouts so loudly, it's very hard to hear the very quiet, because the voice of the heart is the quietest voice you will ever hear. Yeah. It is so, and the thing is that people expect it to kind of be a loud voice, like it is, like the ego voice in the head. However, because it's in here, in the heart, it talks to us through our feelings, through our emotions. Yeah. And that's where EFT comes into its own, because it connects us into those emotions. And those emotions are literally running just below the surface. And that's what we can do. When we tap, we are literally touching our emotions. Mm. And it's amazing what happens when you start letting them out. because you will find that there's things that happen to you, you know, when you were a child, there were things that happened to you when you were first married, there were things that happened to you last week that have changed, you know, have changed how you think and feel about yourself. And, you know, you may have been in a difficult situation as a child, which you had to then cope with. And so you create certain coping strategies around that. Yes. Excuse me. But what happens is we have those coping strategies as a child. Then when we grow up, we end up keeping those same childlike coping strategies around us. Only we've covered it up with all these different layers.
Right.
And we think to ourselves that because I'm not being bullied at school anymore, I'm fine. You know, I don't need to worry about that. And then you end up in a place at work where someone's bullying you. Oh, sorry, my throat's drying out a little. And you find that those little things will start just shaped. start shaping how you think and feel, and until you get back down into that child that was that needed to create these coping mechanisms around, until you dismantle those old coping mechanisms, you will not be able to move on fully. And that's what EFT will do, and it will do it very gently, and it will do it in exactly the right order for you as well. And what your logical mind thinks is the problem is very rarely what the actual problem is.
Right.
Because the way that our emotions work, the way that our emotions and our brain works, is that our brain's like your computer, where you've got all these different folders. You know, as you're arranging all everything, you have different topics, don't you? So this folder looks after this, and this folder looks after that. Okay. Well, it's the same in our brain with our emotions. So everything that we experience that we label as embarrassment all goes in the folder marked embarrassment. And everything that we feel that is joy goes into the folder marked joy. And everything that feels uncomfortable, we put in that. And so what happens is that you end up in a place where you feel embarrassed. And there are so many different situations. You know, I remember when I was at school one time, we always had to walk around the outside of the building. Well, where we were pretty close to the coast. So in the wintertime, there would be a hell of a scales blowing up. I walked round the corner one day and my skirt blew up in my face. And of course, there's boys round the corner, isn't there? How embarrassing is that when you're 13? It's like, oh my God. So and you're like, oh, that was so embarrassing. And but you have these feelings of and of course, you can't show that you're mortified, you're embarrassed, because everybody's going to laugh at you. So you stuff these feelings right down inside because, no, it's okay. And all you want to do is just run into the toilet cubicle and hide and cry. But you can't do that either because they'll hear you crying. So you have to stuff the whole thing down. And then something else might happen to you, you know, when you're much older and you're on a night out and you end up making a complete fool of yourself and you end up totally embarrassed. But again, because you were drunk and you stuffed it back down again. Mm-hmm. And then what can happen is you can end up in the supermarket queue. You hand over your credit card, it gets declined, and there's a massive queue behind you, and people start. And you feel so embarrassed.
That's true.
And you can't show it. So you stuff those feelings down. Now, those are three completely different scenarios.
Right.
All of which you become, suffered embarrassment with.
Yeah.
So when you decide that it's time to look up my money worries and you start burrowing into them, one of the first things you'll find is that you will come up with that memory of being embarrassed. But what you may very well do before you get to the memory of being embarrassed by handing over your credit card, which got declined, is you'll remember that you got embarrassed when you were 13 and you were at school and your skirt blew up. And everything. And once you get to that original one, everything after that just cut. And it's like, oh, my God. So I've been doing all that because when I was at school, my skirt blew up. Everybody saw my knickers and it was really embarrassing. And I've now conducted half of my life on the basis that everybody saw my knickers when I was 13. So it's like when you actually realize that that is what has been driving you for all these years, it's like, oh, well, I can let go of that now. I'm not 13. And so what if they saw my knickers? I'm that's okay. I can live with that. But the memory, you know, sometimes it can be a fleeting thing like that. And other times, of course, with your finances, you know, those embarrassing moments, they pile on one after the other, because, you know, you might be, you know, if you declined in one place and it'll be declined somewhere else, and then there'll be something else that happens, and you get up with these, all these things that just sort of like accumulate. And until you start unwrapping them, then you never really know what is at the bottom of it. Because as humans, we are totally driven by our emotions. And our emotions are formed, you know, from a very, very young age. And we actually learn as adults to try and manipulate our emotions. But if you look at how children deal with emotions, they deal with emotions very differently. They deal with them as they're meant to be, which is in the moment. Emotions don't last long. They last seconds. Right. And but we start teaching our children to hold those emotions in and to not allow them to get through. You know, when a child is throwing a tantrum, it's not that they cannot express fully the emotions that they're feeling inside. They're feeling frustrated. They're feeling angry. They're feeling unloved. They're feeling all, and so they don't know what to do with it. So it all comes out in this great big tantrum, and there's all this physical movement. And then at the end of the tantrum, what happens? They're laughing. They see so, and they just go from one extreme to the other. And that is the true range of an emotion. That is what emotions are. They laugh. They're like that. They are fleeting things. But because we get taught as children to, no, stop having that tantrum. Do not do. So you have to stuff the feelings down, stuff them down, and stuff them down. So you end up with this warped way of seeing things. And that's what tapping will help you to do. It will help you to open up those old feelings, first of all, but it will also allow you to learn to process your current feelings as well.
Right.
So I had a little incident at the beginning of last winter, sort of about November time, when I was taking my dogs out for a walk in the evening. Mm-hmm. There's a guy that lives nearby. He's an alcoholic, and he's got a very badly behaved dog. My dogs and I were walking past, and I knew where his house was, but I was in a little world of my own that night. I was in a lovely, happy mood, as it happens. I was in a little world of my own, and I hadn't realized we'd gone close to his house and that his dog was out in the front yard. Next thing I know, this dog suddenly launches itself at the gate. My dogs go off like a rocket, and I end up literally flat on the floor. I ended up with taking the skin off my knees. I ended up spraining my wrist. I hurt my ankle. I just about got, and then to make it worse, there was three teenagers on bikes right behind me. And they just about managed to stop in time. If they hadn't managed to stop in time, they'd have piled on top of me as well. And that would have been a great, you know, great piley on the bikes, dogs and people. So, of course, you know, you get up. I was so shocked. I was like, oh, my God, what just happened? And, of course, I could barely walk because I was, you know, I was limping. It's very hard to limp on two legs. I had two dogs but I thought, this is my opportunity to actually process everything that's going on inside me right now. And that's what I did. As I carried on walking home, I allowed all that adrenaline to come out. I allowed all the anger to come out. I allowed all the hurt, the embarrassment, the humiliation, the sheer irritation that I felt, you know, how dare we? Will he please get his life together, stop drinking his life away and, you know, get some control over it? And I just let all of that out. And by the time I got home 15 minutes later, although I was still physically injured, emotionally, I was back at a place of balance. And I just thought, wow, I've never been able to do that before, because our temptation as adults is to go back to stuff it down, you know. And then what we do is anything really awful, we then dine out on it for months. You know, it's like, oh, my God, that guy with the dog. And I was like, and you just go over it over and over and over it.
Right.
And I learned to let the whole thing go. And it's like, okay. So, you know, it was a massive learning lesson for me. And that is one of the things that EFT will do for you, is really get you to that place where you can just deal with those emotions like that, so that you don't have to in 6 months, 12 months, 5 years, 10 years, go back and say, oh my God, that was that night when that guy, that drunk guy's dogs had a go at mine. And well, so
we have 1 second. We have C. Will is here, and to the right of you, you'll see he says that he likes to see emotions as waves. He says if you let them flow, it's okay. But if you fight them, it will eventually
wear you down
to a negative effect. And then you learn how to just kind of let them out without going lashing out or hurting other people because you're so upset, or even hurting, you know, yourself at the same time. So that's
exactly. Yep. And that's it. And so that is what EFT will do. It will help you to manage your emotions in the moment, so that, you know, if something happens to knock you off stride, you can come back onto that, you can come back into that place where you feel balanced again, and you can come back really quickly. And the same, you know, so when you work with it for your money, the same thing will happen. If you get hit by an unexpected bill, you'll be like, oh, you know, once upon a time you would have gone, oh my God, how am I ever going to cope with this? Every time I get some money together, there's another bill there, and you go off into this little rant, you know, in your mind. And then what you can do is you can go, oh, okay, well, I wasn't really expecting that, but so how am I feeling about that? And it gives you the opportunity to just have a look at that and say, now, is this bringing up anything that I need to look at? You know, that is this bringing up some old things that I haven't yet remembered to look at? Mm-hmm. And so it gives you the opportunity to then dive into it and see, how do I really feel about it? And then you realize that how you feel, you have a complete choice over. You do not have to stay in that place of feeling bad. No. You can choose at any moment to say, I don't want to feel like that.
Right.
I'm going to stop thinking about that. I'm going to stop doing, you know, and I'm going to think about this instead. And if you do find yourself being drawn back to, it's like, okay, so what do I need to do? So that's when I'll turn to my tapping, or I will turn to my angels, or I, you know, there'll be some way of saying to myself, okay, we've got to take this, and we've got to find out what this is about, because this is coming back again. So why has it come back again? So, you know, so we look at things like that. And then when you look at India, yes, I didn't quite get around to looking at that, did I? So it gives you an opportunity to really feel into it, let go of those old emotions and say, right, well, how do I feel now? Almost like, how does the grown-up me feel? How does the real balanced me feel about it? And then you should look at it. Oh, it's just a bill.
Yes.
It just needs something that just needs paying. Oh, okay. So I know I haven't quite got enough this week, but I can put something towards it for next week, and we'll have the rest of it by then. And, you know, and if necessary, I can always pay part of it now and pay part less, you know. And you can actually sort of, you can then see your way out of it, and it's like, oh, done, sorted, don't need to worry about it. And it's, you know, and it's over and done with. So you can, so that is what EFT will do, is it will really help you to balance your emotions in the moment, so that you can then keep your life on an even keel. And you then start becoming really aware of any time that you start thinking to yourself in a negative way, or you start feeling down, or you feel your mood dip, you become really aware of it so much more quickly than you used to. I mean, I've suffered with terrible depression over my life since in my early teens, all sorts of different forms of it over the years. But since I started seriously working with my EFT and really got myself emotionally balanced, this has been the first winter that I've been through where I haven't ended up falling into some kind of depression, whether it's seasonal affective disorder or into a serious slump, because I'm now able to pick up on those thoughts very quickly, and I'm able to pick up on my mood sliding, and I'm able to pick up on it within minutes, or, you know, occasionally hours, when I suddenly realize I'm feeling a bit, oh, and I've been feeling this way for a few hours. And that's when I can say, okay, so what's going on here? You know, what's triggered this? And again, I can then say, once I realize what the trigger is, I can then say to myself, Jake, Jake, sit. Sorry, one of my dogs. Come over here. He wants to lean on my desk, and it's one of those little tiny flimsy student desks. So it's not really designed for leaning on by dogs. So you could take that opportunity to say, what's really going on here? You know, why am I feeling this way? Right, well, let's let that go. Okay. So that's one of the other benefits that I was just not expecting to happen through EFT. So it is a remarkably powerful, but so simple and so effective. I say it's a technique you can learn in minutes that will last you a lifetime. No, Jake's my dog. Well, one of my dogs.
Oh my gosh. That would have been hilarious. Like, look, listen, Jake, calm down.
I know. But, you know, well, that is something that, there is something that, you know, that people can do to actually help them in their, as they're actually learning to tame the voice of the ego, is you can actually give your ego voice a name. You can actually get, and you can actually start, because one of the things to remember is that our ego is also a gift from God as well. But what's happened is it's been allowed to get out of control, and it's been allowed to rule the world instead of our hearts. But our ego has some incredible abilities. It's really good at organizing. It's really good at remembering. It's really good at helping us just to sort of get through and plan our days. So you can really turn it around so that it serves you. And so you can literally have this conversation with your ego and say, look, I love what you do. We are in this body together. So let's become friends. Now, you are really good at this, and I am really good at that. I am the captain, and you are the first mate. Your job is to bring to my attention the things that need sorting out, but you are not in charge. I am in charge. And you can have this two-way conversation, which will actually then help you, so that if you suddenly become aware that your ego is shouting very loudly, and you're going, hold on a minute, and you go, there's only room for one of us in this head, so what are you trying to... And you can actually, you know, I mean, I actually call my ego Jeremiah, which I know sounds a little bit odd, but that was the name that I gave it. And since I did that, and I become aware and think, Jeremiah, you're trying to run the things again. You can't be doing that. I'm in charge, remember. What is it that you're wanting me to know? And so when we start learning to work with our gifts from God, which the ego is part of, then we can actually start making these really incredible changes in our lives. Because we can say, well, I need to... I've got this, and this to do this week. You know, these are my projects for the week. Jeremiah, I need your help with doing this, with that. And it will actually, you know, your ego will then go, oh, brilliant, I've got something to do. So when you give it something to do,
right,
it's brilliant. And the trouble is that when it has nothing to do, it's like a naughty child. You know, if you don't, you know, small children, if you ignore them, will misbehave. Well, your ego is exactly the same. Give it a job to do. Say, right, well, you're in charge of this. Now I'm going to be doing such and such a thing. Is there anything I need to know about it? You know, and it's like, it's amazing what a difference it will make, because it has so many really powerful skills. So get those skills on your side, and it will help your life to take off as well. So not only do you open your heart, but you also have this great helper on your side who is built in. So that is one of the things that you can really do to really change how you feel, not only about your money, but about how you feel about yourself, because all of a sudden you've got a friend on your side. And so when we learn to, because so much of the spiritual talk is around making the ego the enemy. And when we make part of ourselves the enemy, we're at war with ourselves. You know, the ego is a part of ourselves that it will always be there. But it will also, if you train it right, you know, like anything, if you give it the right things to do, it will really help to shift and change your life. So,
yeah. So I know one thing that I call her Shahana, you know, because there's like two of them, you know, Shahana, is the rowdy, and she just always got some. Oh, do you really, really, you know, Shahana, she's like really ghetto, you know? And then, there's oh my God, what name? Because I actually kind of went into myself and asked for the names, and that's what kind of came up. So I have one.
Yep.
The other one is Ashanti. That's her name. Ashanta is how it came out. So Ashanta. Now, Asanda is the name that came up. Now, Asanda, she's more of a helper. She's more like, okay, what Shahana is saying, she's only saying that because that's what you've been believing for so long. Mm-hmm. So now let me show you how to alleviate what Shahana created so that Asanda can kind of help you. I can help you, you know, still keeping your ego self. Because sometimes you need that part of yourself to give you that, maybe you might need that extra little courage or that extra little nudge. So you kind of step into that ego self, yeah. Like, I got this. I know that I can do this. I can get out of debt within a year. I can do that. You know, so when Shahana goes, I can get out of debt, please. You've been in debt for so long. Blah, blah, blah. And then, you know, and then Asanda says, honey, you can't get out of debt. You just need to apply yourself. And remember who you are. You are the driver. So, you know, this Shahana, she'll kind of shut up. She'll kind of die down. When Asanda steps in, she's very assertive. She knows what she wants. She knows what has to be done. And it's like, come on, we really don't have time to listen to Shahana today. We got work to do.
Yeah,
sit your behind down. You know, it's yep. really a beautiful thing. But, you know, people will think you crazy. Yeah. And you got all these voices going on in your head. And they have the same voices. They just don't know what those voices are, you know what I mean? To understanding and comprehension of them. But one thing I wanted to ask you, and then we're going to actually go ahead and get into a little tapping segment so you guys can actually experience what tapping is. I now have her address that for you guys so you can actually understand what is EFT. So, what was the question that I had? For you. Oh, I know what it was. It was, what are some of the most common things that you realize that people are blocked with when it comes to their finances? Like, what do you find to be the most thing that's in the way of them becoming financially free or alleviating those beliefs that have kept them, you know, hostage for so long?
One of the things that women in particular are very prone to do when it comes to money is they tie their self-esteem and their finances together. Mm-hmm. So when your finances hit rock bottom, then it drags your self-esteem down. When your self-esteem hits rock bottom, it drags your finances down. So one of the key things I've had to learn to do is I've had to learn to feel good about myself regardless of what my financial position was. So whether I was deep in debt or whether I had money flowing, I had to learn to feel good regardless. So that takes quite a bit of work, but that again is one of the things that EFT will do, is as you start clearing out all those old beliefs, is your confidence will rise, because all of a sudden your thinking changes and your beliefs around it will change. That is a really common thing, particularly for women to do, because women have a very strong driver to be liked and to be accepted. And if we feel in some ways that we are going to be unliked or we're going to be rejected in some ways, we find it really hard to actually get out there in the world and really show up as who we really are. And this is particularly prevalent among women entrepreneurs. We really can struggle to get out there and really give the very best of who we are.
Yes.
Because we don't feel that confident inside. And the entrepreneurial path will push every button you've ever had and a few that you didn't know you had, particularly your financial buttons. Because in the entrepreneurial world, in the world of your business, every decision you make has got a financial implication to it. you decide to go to a networking meeting and you follow up on with everybody, and afterwards you will then make yourself probably some new clients. So that has a financial implication. Another time, you can go to a different networking event, collect lots of contacts, and not follow them up. That also has a financial implication to your business, but that has a negative financial implication. So it doesn't matter what it is that you do within your business, everything has a financial implication. And that can, when you have a poor relationship with money, that can completely paralyze you from being out there and being your very best you. Many of the women that I work with are very sensitive, they're very shy, they're very introverted. And for women, for introverted women entrepreneurs, it can be a complete struggle to go through the selling process, to actually have to go to the point of asking someone to pay them to do their, you know, for their coaching, or for, you know, for, you know, if they make things, you know, for actually asking for the sale to buy things. So it can be a real big struggle to actually help, you know, to actually get out there. But they have this burning desire inside of them to run that business, and to and they can't, so they're torn between their desire to run the business and to be that business, right, and to also want to hide away because, you know, somebody might not like me, and somebody might, you know, I might talk to a prospective client and they may just say no, and I don't know, I'm not sure I could handle that, you know. And so there's all kinds of things kind of get hidden in with that whole thing. So it can be really difficult, you know, for women entrepreneurs to get out there and to really get their self-esteem to a place where they feel good regardless of what's going on. And that's where tapping will come into its own, because it will enable you to open up. It will enable you to open up to your own gifts as well. Because one of the things that may be actually stopping your business from growing is that you're actually trying to take it down the wrong road. In my sort of recovery period, I had the dressmaking business, and then I realized that what I really wanted to do was my coaching, because I've got my coaching qualifications several years before, but again had done nothing with them. So I started off trying to be a business coach, and then I started off trying, because I'd learned lots about marketing, I thought, well, maybe I can help marketing. I could maybe do small business marketing. Right. Well, maybe I could do this. And so because my self-esteem was still really low, I had direction to go in. And so as I started working with my EFT and started really clearing and clarifying, and once I accepted that I was going to have to teach about money, it was like, oh no. And then once I actually said, okay, I'm going to start teaching about money,
right,
that is when clients and potential clients began to appear, because I'd taken that clarity. And that's when people start, I was like, so when you're actually working with your EFT, it will really help to raise up your self-esteem. And so you can really see if you're actually heading in the right direction. So, you know, a lot of my clients, they suddenly realize that, oh my God, no wonder I've got no business. I'm trying to be everything to everybody. And I can't do that. You know, I really want to work with people who manufacture mugs. You know, that is who I love. You know, I've spent all my life working in the mug industry, and now I want to go out and help people to make their own mugs. And I was trying to help people who made glasses, or I was trying to help people who made phone cases, and I was trying to appeal to all these people. And this, all of a sudden, they realized that is what they put on earth to do. And when they have those moments of clarity, it's like, oh, and then everything falls into place. And the whole thing, so that's when money will really start flowing into your life, because as the clients start appearing, so then the money starts appearing. And that then gives you the opportunity then to start growing again, because all of a sudden you kind of go from a, you know, place where your business isn't doing too well to, oh, it's starting to grow. And then that can also bring up a whole host of other things. It's like, oh my God, I'm successful. I'm not supposed to be successful. People like me don't get successful. You know, nobody in our family's ever done this before. Nobody in my neighborhood's ever done this before. Ah, what am I going to do? None of my friends has ever done. And all of a sudden, so you start getting a whole new raft of different things. So
that's so true.
So you've gone through this massive thing to get you to the point where you're starting to succeed. And that's when it's like, oh, help. And suddenly you find yourself, you know, like you were at the beginning of your business, like a rabbit in the headlights. It's like, oh, I've got these clients and I don't know what to do. Oh my God, what am I going to do? and then you try and analyze it. And then you end up stuck in the analysis and you're like, and it's like, and all it is yet more emotion needing to come out, because, right, you know, at some point, and because the reason we end up becoming afraid of our own success is that at some point somebody will have said to you, you're getting too big for your boots, lady, you come down back down to size, you're getting to, and there'll be someone somewhere who will have told you that you are too big for yourself, mm-hmm, that you were, you know, the, oh, I think one of my dad's favorite phrases, you've always got to have the last word, haven't you? I'm a teacher, I can't help you. But all those things are designed to shut you down. And so when you start getting to a place in your business where you're opening up, then all of a sudden those old memories come back. Hey, you're getting too big for your boots, lady. You get back down. It's like, okay then. So you end up, you know, so you start missing client appointments, or you start putting it off, or you find, you know, you talk to somebody who's a prospective client and you make such a hash of the call that it's like, oh no, they're just not. Or then, you know, you might go to a networking meeting and you just don't bother following up because, you know, it's like, oh, well, I've got enough work for now. I'm fine. You know, I don't need to worry about it. Mm-hmm. So, you know, so that, and that's, you know, that's something else that often happens, particularly for women, is they go through that feast and famine stage with their business. It's like, it's either work. Oh my God, all that work's finished. Right. What am I supposed to do now? Right. And so I actually help them to stop, you know, to help, because, you know, when things are going really well and you're really busy in your business, you're starting to get the money to flow. So what women tend to do is they tend to forget to market and promote the business. They tend to think, oh, I made it. I don't need to worry about all that anymore. Yeah. And then all of a sudden they realize that those contracts are coming to an end, that those clients have suddenly disappeared. And it's like, oh my God. And so then they have to start the whole thing again. So they've lost, you know, there's one of the laws of the universe is the law of momentum.
Yeah.
And so when you start growing your business, you have this momentum growing, which will, but the thing with momentum is when it first starts, oh, it's like pushing water uphill. But eventually you get to the point where the energy starts flowing and those clients come in and the money starts flowing in and you start thinking, oh, that's great. And so people are then very tempted to take their foot off the pedal and go, yep, I'm cool, everything's okay. And that's the point at which you need to really start, you know, look at that momentum you built and keep them, and then start looking for the opportunity to go to the next level. You know, if you're a coach and you're working, you know, with 5 clients, maybe your next milestone is to work with 10 clients,
yeah,
or maybe it's to start developing a program, or maybe it's to, you know, so you've got to keep taking the momentum you've got from where you are and taking some of that to build up to the next level and to the next level. And every level you get to on your business, you will get to a point where you start feeling like that rabbit in the head, and it's like, okay, so now I need to have a look at that. Now I need to let go of this, you know. So, okay, now I've hit my first 4-figure month. Now I've hit my first 5-figure month. Oh my God, you know, this is really working for me, you know. And then all of a sudden it's like, oh, I've run out of money again. Right. So what am I going to do? I didn't work when I was doing really well. I didn't keep working on my beliefs. I didn't keep making sure I was going to move to the next level. So, you know
what happens too is that when that happens, and then you start tapping or trying to clear your energy up, it doesn't work as fast as before because now you're doing it out of fear. Oh my God, I don't have no more money. I ran out of money.
Yeah. Yeah. Now, and it's like, ah, where do I go? It's happened again. And then you're like, ah, it's happened again. Why am I doing this? So then you get caught in the why, in the whys. And when you get caught in the whys, all that does is it closes you down. And so one of the ways that you can actually open it up is you can say, well, how can I move forward from this? Or how can I, what's the next step I can take? And when we start using questions like that, which have got movement built into them, you're like, how do I move forward? How can I take a step? What's the next step? And so on. When we start using questions like that with the energy, that opens things up. But when we start saying, oh, why does this always happen to me? It's not fair. Oh, no. Why questions will close you down and will get you stuck in here. And that's when Jeremiah will go, oh, well, let's... And he's like, oh, shut up, will you? So getting all of those things, you know, and just getting all of those things together and just say, right, I'm going to take this, I'm going to take this energy and I'm going to grow it. And as I'm growing, I'm going to become really aware of where my pinch points are, so that as I get to them, I can easily overcome them and let them go, and I can keep this growth. And that is, you know, that becomes so important, is to learn to keep that. And then you can start overcoming that feast and famine cycle that happens to so many solo entrepreneurs. So so that's my kind of take on what we can think. So.
Awesome. Now, before we start the session, I would like you to just real briefly take about a minute or so and just explain to them what tapping is, so that they can know exactly what it is. Some people may not be familiar with tapping or EFT, so I guess you can give them the actual definition of what the word is, what EFT stands for.
I will indeed. So,
background, nothing too long, too lengthy, but we'll put background.
No, I'd say EFT, it stands for Emotional Freedom Technique, and it's called tapping because that's literally what we do. We tap on ourselves. And EFT works through what's called the meridian system. Now, the meridian system is the energy systems that go through our body that was identified through Chinese medicine over 3,000 years ago. So they have literally got maps of energy where the energy will flow through different parts of the system. It goes flow through all of the different major organs in the body. And each of those meridians is also responsible for maintaining our emotional health as well. Because when you think about it, our emotions are very, very fluid. They move through our bodies. So we can feel something in our gut and we can feel it coming out as well. So our emotions, they actually move as well. So they work through our, and it works through the meridian system. And what we do is, a lot of the meridians are literally just under the skin. So if you've ever seen or come across acupuncture, you'll know that what they do is they use needles. And what they're doing with the needles is they're using them to actually just go right through into the meridian system itself. So they're actually literally tapping into that energy through the needles. And what the needles will help to do is they will literally talk to each other through the meridian system, and they will help to move the lymph through the body, through the lymph glands, but they will also help to move any stuck areas of stagnant energy. And that is what we can do with the tapping. And of course, you don't need any needles, so anybody who's got a needle phobia, it's brilliant for. And Alf, get down, sweetheart. Sorry, that's my other dog, Alf. He's got himself stuck in the corner. Hold on a second.
Yes.
Right.
Awesome.
So that's basically it. Before we start, I want to
ask them if they had did you guys have any additional questions about tapping before we actually get into the actual tapping session? Because I just kind of want everybody to be clear. Thank you, Regina. Whoever wants to hop, if you want to hop in the vibe speaks, the vibe spot. For just a moment, you can. So I did open the seat if anybody wants to come into the seat for just a moment, just to ask a question about tapping or energy or anything like that, you can. So I'll give you guys about 5 seconds to get into that. And in the meantime, we're going to listen to some tapping. We'll give it a minute. And but the tapping that we're going to be listening to is not tapping with our hands, but tapping feet. You know, everything is energy. You know, even someone that actually does tap dancing, we're still dealing with energy.
I love watching tap dancing. It's one of my favorite things. I love watching it. It's amazing.
Tap dancing, right?
Yep, love it. Love all forms of dancing.
And I sure would like some sweet gum.
I always like to do, you know. I really see what's happening, but okay. So let's get right into. Oh, she says thank you. Gina says thank you, Tanya.
You're very welcome.
Oh. All right, guys. So I want you guys to really get prepared for this because. I tapped my way out of a whole lot of stuff. Literally.
Okay, so what I'll do is I will just run over with you where the main tapping points are that we work with. So the first one that we do is just here. It's called the karate chop point. So you know when you see the kung fu masters doing that and then breaking the piles of bricks? Well, it's that point in the hand. And the reason they use that point is that they're because of the energy that's in there, they're able to actually send that energy out through their hand right the way through. So that's how they can work. That's how they work the. That's how they break everything. Then the next point we look at is just here. It's the eyebrow point. So where your eyebrow is just above your nose, just here. That's where we our next one. And then, I'll just take my glasses off for a minute. The next one we work on is just here. It's at the corner of the eye. It's just on the eye socket, just here on the edge. And then the next one is just here, just under the eye. Again, just on the eye socket here. And you don't have to tap hard. You just have to, you know, just very gently. The next one is just under the nose, just here. And then next one is in the chin. Then we've got the collarbone points, which are just here. So where your collarbone is, here. And then about an inch or so below it. And then the next one is just under the arm here. And then the last one is just at the very top of the head. So that's where that's where the final point is. And whenever we start off a tapping session, we can do one of two things with tapping. We can either tap to release or we can tap to put in positive energy. So what we're going to do today is we're going to tap to actually release. And when we're looking for something to release, what we do is we start off with what's called a setup statement. And the setup statement starts off by saying, even though I, and then you describe the situation exactly as you see it. And then at the end of it, you say, I still deeply and completely love and accept myself. And that's the beautiful thing about tapping is you say it as you see it. So if it's a situation that makes you really angry, say it and say it with the words if you need to. You know, nobody's listening. If you want to use rude words, you use rude words. It depends how you see it. No one sees a situation other than the way that you do. So just let it out. And that is what the whole thing is about. This is a releasing process. So you can also use tapping to actually help you to then go the other way, which is to then imprint yourself with really positive energy. So you can, you know, so when we're looking at our money, the first thing we want to do is we want to let go of the bad habits. But then what we want to do is we want to encourage ourselves to start putting in some good habits and to start thinking about money in a really positive way. That's how I will always run my sessions is we focus first of all on the letting go and then we focus on the bringing in of the good. So it all helps to just, you know, because what will happen is you will get to a point in your time and you will literally feel a sense of relief, like, oh, thank goodness for that. You can actually feel a physical release in yourself as you actually let go of that belief. And when you get to that point, that's when you know that you can then start tapping in the good stuff. It's like, oh, yes. Now, sometimes what can happen as well during a tapping is, because obviously we're dealing with emotions, we can get a little bit overwhelmed, and you can sometimes find yourself feeling tearful. Now, this is, again, it's a perfectly normal thing, because our tears are our emotional outlet. In the same way that if you fill a bath, when you fill your bath with water, you've got the overflow. And the reason the overflow is there is if you leave the water running, eventually the bath fills, and when it hits the overflow, it can. And that's what our tears are. That is our inbuilt overflow system. So if you're feeling a little bit tearful, just let those tears roll, because it is part of the releasing and healing process. Somebody called them our inner ocean, and that's exactly what they do. It brings out a wave of emotion that brings out that salty energy. So again, it's very healing. So if you're feeling, you find yourself feeling a little bit tearful, that is part and parcel of the healing. So, and then sometimes it goes the other way, where you can't stop giggling. You know, when you find something funny, but you don't know why you find it funny and you can't stop giggling. That is another way that we release energy as well. So whatever reaction you get, it's perfectly normal. Sometimes you may also find that you get, you might get a sudden spiking pain somewhere in your body. That, again, it will be one of your meridian systems loosening up the energy. And sometimes, because I often find it, particularly in my toe joints, my big toe joints, I'll get a sudden burst of pain, and then I go, ooh, ow, that feels better, because you know then that the energy is really moving. So your body will give you amazing feedback as to how you're doing with releasing all of those emotions.
And also, one thing I want to add too is yawning. So that.
Yes. Yeah.
That when you're you might find yourself all of a sudden you feel all tired and sleepy. It's not really that, it's releasing.
Yeah. Yeah. And the other thing that will happen is you might suddenly get twitches, you know, or you might want to just move your shoulders or something, or you can sometimes literally like, woo, oh, okay. And again, that's just the energy shifting. So, you know,
my eyeballs like roll in the back of my head sometimes.
Yeah. Yep, and all that is just a sign of energy shifting and clearing. So yep. Okay.
All right, you guys ready? You guys ready? Come on, ahead.
Okay. So, is there any particular topic that anybody would like us to focus on, or should we just work on money as a whole?
I think we should just do money as a whole. Are you guys paying attention? I just want to make sure I have everyone's attention before you start. Just give us some hands over here if you likes or something, or one like or something, so we just know that you guys are actually paying attention and ready. Perfect. Thank you.
Lovely. Okie dokie. Right. So what we're going to do is we'll just start off with us. So we'll start off tapping here. So what I'll do is I will say a phrase, and then Takiya, if you then just follow her, and then when Takiya speaks, if you guys then speak along with her. So I'll speak it nice and easily and slowly for you, so you can easily understand, and then we'll just keep working our way through it. Okay. So we'll just start off by just gently tapping on the karate chop point. And we'll just say, even though I find money a challenge.
Even though I find money a challenge.
And I've struggled with it.
And I struggle with it.
And I've been really down about it.
And I would think really down about it.
I still deeply and completely love and accept myself.
I still deeply and completely love and accept myself.
Okay, so we're going to move on to the eyebrow point now. I used to hate money.
I used to hate money.
It scared me.
It scared me.
If anybody mentioned money, I just wanted to walk out the room.
If anybody mentioned money, I'm ready to walk out the room.
I'm going to let that go now.
I'm going to let that go now.
Oh, that feels better.
Feels better.
Okay, so let's go onto the corner of the eye. I wish I knew why I was so scared of money.
I wish I knew why I was so scared of money.
It's only paper.
It's only paper.
It's only any metal.
Doesn't collect any matter.
It can't hurt me.
It can't hurt me.
So why am I so scared of it?
So why am I so scared of it?
I'm gonna let that go now.
I'm gonna let that go now.
I'm gonna go under the eyes now. There really is nothing to be scared of, is there?
There really is nothing to be scared of, is it?
Oh, that is such a relief.
That's such a relief.
All these years I've been scared of money.
All these years I've been scared of money.
And actually, money really wants to come to me.
But actually, money really wants to come to me.
I've been holding it back.
I've been holding it back.
Oh my God, what am I going to do?
Oh my God, what am I going to do?
Let's go under the nose. Oh my, I was scared of money. And it stayed away.
And it stayed away.
And if I hadn't been scared of it.
And if I hadn't been scared of it.
It would have been here all the time.
It would have been here all the time.
I created what I was most scared of.
I created what I was most scared of.
Which was no money.
Which was no money.
Oh, it's time to let that go now.
Woo! It's time to let that go now.
Oh my God, I have spent years doing this to myself.
I spent years doing this to myself.
I'm going to let that go.
But I'm going to let that go.
Let's move on to our chin point. Oh my, when I think about money now.
When I think about money now?
I feel excited.
I get excited.
Money wants to work with me.
Money wants to work with me.
It wants to stay around me.
It wants to stay around me.
It wants to support me.
It wants to support me.
It's been waiting for me.
It's been waiting for me.
All I have to do.
All I have to do.
Is reach out.
Is reach out.
And say thank you.
And say thank you.
And you're welcome into my life.
And you're welcome into my life.
Let's move on to our collarbone point. Oh, that is such a relief.
Oh, that is such a release.
All the money I've ever wanted.
All the money I've ever wanted.
Is on its way.
Is on its way.
I can feel it.
I can feel it.
I can see it.
I can feel it.
It's amazing.
It's amazing.
I'm rich.
I'm rich.
And I didn't know it.
And I do know.
I thought I was poor.
I didn't know it. And I thought I was poor.
I'm rich.
I'm rich.
Oh my God.
Oh my God.
Let's go under the arm. I have believed such real fairy stories.
I have really funny, just really fairy stories.
All those myths about money are they're wrong.
All those myths about money were all wrong.
Money wants to look after me.
Money wants to look after me.
Oh, wow. And for the first time, I'm going to be taken care of.
For the first time, I'm going to be taken care of.
I'm really excited.
I'm really excited.
Because this money will grow my business.
Will grow my business.
And will support me on my mission.
Will support me on my mission.
Oh my God.
Oh my God.
Let's go to the top of the head. I can live my dream now.
I can live my dream now.
My dreams are coming true right before my eyes.
My dreams are coming true right before my eyes.
Because I now see money for what it is.
Because I now see money for what it is.
Something to help me.
Something to help me.
And all I had to do.
And all I have to do.
Was ask it. To come into my life. And to welcome it. I welcome money. I am rich. Woo!
I am rich. Woo!
Oh, wow. That is wealth.
Now that is wealth.
Okay, so let's take all this lovely energy that we've created and we're going to take it and we're going to place it right where it belongs in our hearts. And right now, in our hearts, we have got the excitement that we feel about our purpose in life, but more importantly, that our purpose is going to be supported financially, that we have nothing to worry about on the finance front. Everybody, well done. That was amazing. Well done.
Good job. Regina said thank you.
You're welcome, Regina. You're welcome, lovely. Thank you for being here.
Yeah, so I would love for someone to hop in the vibe seat and tell us what you experienced. Is anybody not afraid to hop into the hot seat?
Take all that energy from your money healing just now and just jump into the hot seat where we'd love to talk to you.
Yes. Come on over. See, Will, I know you would. Come on over. Come on over, guys. Somebody, come on over. Don't be scared.
we obviously did too good a job of making them feel good.
It's fine. Some people get afraid of the hot seat. It's okay. You guys can even type it in the chat. Just, you know, what that experience was for you.
We've got someone calling in there.
Oh, okay. Here we go. Yeah, that's my boy right here. He's a showstopper. Come on. What's wrong with this thing? Wait, see, Will, go out and come back. It has you stuck, baby. Look at the top left. Oh, okay. Thank you, because I would have never looked at it. What was that?
Hey, hello.
Hello. Hi, Tanya. Yeah, they changed the format, the way you let people in now. So.
Oh, really?
It's over there where the question, where the tweet thing and that. Yeah, so you got to say yes or no there.
Some other guy was trying to come in today. I don't know who he was, but I knew he was about to probably be on some extra stuff because he ain't have nothing attached to his name. So I'm like, I'm not accepting him in the chat room. You know what happened last time. Yeah. We had some
crazy. Yeah. That's what's cool. You can see their whole profile. I mean, you can see all their whatever in that.
Oh, so wonderful.
And if you have more than one person, you can see the different colors too. So it's
awesome. Well, good. Okay, Vlad, they updating. Okay, they coming out of beta. See well. Hey, mom. So, please share with us, what was that experience like for you? Is that your first time ever tapping before?
No, no, I've known about it for a while, and so I really appreciate this. I like learning more about it and how it works and how to actually come up with your own scripts when things come up, you know, and you know, so I like that. Describe how it feels to you, and different things like that. And I was watching and I was listening, and so I was trying to do it, trying to follow along. And it was interesting. So I was watching Takia Diamond here, and she's very expressive, and you know, and some of the things started happening to me. So I was wondering, is yawning, is that part of, is, cause is that like a reaction to what, like the energy moving through you, or maybe trying to go unconscious to try to resist it or something?
No, yawning is a part of releasing. Mm-hmm. It comes up not even just with tapping, but almost any type of energy healing that's done. Anytime it's releasing, either you experience yawning or like a deep sigh of like, like, you know. Sometimes when I'm assisting people on my own, sometimes they might feel like something moving. You might get like a tingling in your head or like in your fingers. And then Tanya, you can share what other little symptoms that they might also.
Yeah. And sometimes you might find yourself literally twitching, you know, it's like, you're like, ooh, and you just feel like you need to move your body in some way. And that is a sign of the energy really starting to move through you, so that you've just started, like, it's almost the point where you can't stop it. And it's just, then she's yawning away. But, you know, energy
is going to go on for me for probably like the next 2 to 3 minutes. You guys are going to
continue. Don't stop. Oh, no, you're going to get me going in a minute.
That's what I was like, okay. I was trying not to watch. Because she was trying to hide it. She was trying to hide it. She was doing okay at first, right? She
kept going
like this, you know, and I was like, yeah.
I know.
I didn't want it to distract everybody, but I knew. It was funny because I said it like right before we started, because I know that's one of the ways that I release. And a lot of times of other energy workers that I work with, people will always comment and say, I keep yawning. That's a very common.
And sometimes, like I say, you find that there's part of your body that you can't keep still. Or you might get sudden pains shooting through, so, you know, through a certain part of your body, but they're really, they're short and sweet, I say short and sweet, but they're sort of, you know, they're short and spiky, but then they're gone. And again, that's just the energy shifting. So, because we hold energy through our whole body, you know, we will hold stagnant energy in our joints. So, particularly in the hip area, we will often hold trauma in our hip area. So that's why you can be really you know, your lower back. And of course, we spend so much time on computers now that you get a lot of the energy stuck in your spine as well, because really we're designed for moving around far more than we do now. So as you're actually working with EFT, you will actually find yourself sort of doing this and sort of like, and you'll find yourself trying to sort of like move, and then you realize actually what you're doing is you're then releasing all the energy in the spine, because our spine is actually one of the places where we have really where our main energy centers are, our chakra system.
Right.
And the chakras, I know they usually portray them at the front of the body, but actually they go back as well. So that's why our spinal column's really important part of it. So as we're working, you know, EFT is an energy releaser as well. So you might find yourself doing this in order to actually start releasing some of the stuck energies in the different chakras. And also, you might also find yourself, say, coughing, which is often a sign that your throat chakra is starting to release, and that it will actually, you know, when you actually stuff words down, or you feel like you're in a situation where you can't express yourself. And so we'll end up, keeping the words here. So we're very often, as we start releasing our energy, then those will come up, you know, so it'll be a cough, or you might just sort of be like a tickle, or you might even feel like your throat's actually quite sore. Almost like you're starting with like tonsillitis or something, and that is simply the energy just realigning itself. So some of them, like I say, some of the symptoms can be a little uncomfortable, but that is simply because the energy has got stuck in the physical body, and when it releases, and when we actually consciously release it, that's when it will actually then start. It will start making its way out, and once it's out, then that's it. You know, it's got no hold over you anymore, and you can really move on, and you can find your whole life starts. You know, your body will start feeling freer, as if you started taking up exercise, and all that you've done is you've just released all of that old stuck energy from within you. And when you do that, then it makes a massive difference to your whole life as well.
Yeah, that's a lot where I was at, where I was talking about. Letting the emotions flow, because the damage that you do to yourself, a lot of times we get sick. You know, most illnesses are psychosomatic, right? It's because we're holding on, and it's actually accumulating in a, like you say, in a position, in a location in our body, and eventually it affects those organs in those areas or the joints, and we actually get physically ill, or, you know, get arthritis, et cetera, different things that come from holding on to emotions for too long. So yeah, and I definitely understand that physical release. I think a lot of men hold it in their shoulders as well. You know, I know a lot of women hold it more in their hips and their backside, but you know, men hold it in different places too.
Yes, yeah. The other very common place is around the jaw. You know, people will clench their jaws, and they, you know, so they literally will not, will not say what they need to say. So they'll hold it around the jaw as well. So yeah.
Yeah, definitely see that. Yeah, so yeah, I just noticed that, and I was actually while I was doing, some research.
You was laughing at me, wasn't you?
I was laughing. I was noticing it, and then I saw the way your eyes moving, right? And so are you familiar with NLP and the eye patterns, right? So I'm like, okay, what is because she's processing. I know you're processing, right? So I was like, where is she at? What memories is she accessing? So anyway, I'm not gonna get into all that.
I don't think that I was processing any in particular memory.
Go ahead.
Well, I'm about to say you're right on that. I'm gonna say I wasn't processing a memory that I thought of myself, but my subconscious mind is aware of the memory. So it's moving it on its own. Like, even though you don't know, like with tapping as well, like even if you don't know where it comes from, this knows where it comes from.
Right.
So I said that before she started. I said, you know, so if you guys start seeing my eyeballs going up inside my head or whatever, like that's something that happens often. Like, I could be driving and a block will drop me from me. Like, something will come to me. And it'll just move it, and I'll be like, it feels like something's popping in my brain, like somebody like opened up a bubble. Like, I could actually literally feel the circuits moving in my head. Like, I could feel them moving. I could feel when they're wiring. I could feel when they're popping open. I'm really, really sensitive to it. So sometimes it's just like, I wonder what that was. Okay, well, I don't care. I mean, just as long as you're leaving. I'm good.
That's it. Yep. I don't care what it was. Just go.
Bye. Thank you for doing what you could do while you were here. Now that you're done, please don't come back. Have a nice life. Awesome. So, well, did you have any other questions for Tanya or anyone else? Regina, did you have any other questions? From Tap for Tanya as well, anyone?
So I guess what I'm getting at is, when you're looking to release stuff, I think other stuff may come up, right? And so you may may kind of lead you down a pathway to things that you're not aware of now. Are there any like general ways that you discover those, like where to start from?
I said, well, usually, and say when I'm working on a one-to-one basis with clients, we will start off with the setup statement. And then what I will do is I will just allow them to just say what's coming up in their minds. And your mind and your subconscious will bring up the things that you are ready to let go of at that moment. So what sometimes happens is you end up revisiting a particular topic or a particular memory several times because you're not ready to release the whole thing in one go, but you are ready to release elements of it. So I had a client come and work with me. She signed up for a full 12 sessions, and it was about session 6 before we actually mentioned money. She said, when we first started, she said, I know it sounds odd, but I really want to work on this particular item. And I was like, oh, okay. And I was thinking, I don't know what that's got to do with anything. But we go with what, you know, with what you have to go with what the client is ready to let go of. And so as we worked on that, then some other things came up. And it's as a result of that, we realized that she was kind of going through a big spiritual awakening. And so that's what we had to work on, first of all, was helping her through her spiritual awakening before we could kind of get to the topic of money. But in order to have her to feel comfortable enough to talk about the money side of things, we had to go through all of the work that we needed to do for the spiritual awakening. So it's amazing sometimes what will happen. And, you know, so people will come to me because they think that the problem they've got is money. And actually, it may have nothing to do with money. However, money is the thing that is presenting itself. Above all, you know, what I say is that the thing that I bring my clients to is a good relationship with themselves. Because when, you know, if money is a problem, then what that means is that in some part of themselves that they are not comfortable with. So we will work together to find those parts of themselves that they weren't comfortable with. And as we do that and we go through all that process and that clearing, and then obviously between our sessions, they then do their own tapping sessions as well. It will often bring up things that they were then ready to let go of. And then by the time we get to the end of our period of time together, so they will then be in a much stronger position where they can then really start turning their life around and really start feeling those changes come through. So you will only ever release what you are ready to release at that time. And then we can go back, you can go back to the same topic several times and you will, and then eventually you get to a point and go, that's not an issue anymore. I don't even need to think about it. So I'm ready to move to the next thing. So each one will come up, you know, each time.
Awesome. I'm gonna jump back out, but I'm really enjoying this.
Awesome. Okay. Thank you. So Tiny Will's gonna hop out. He's gonna pop out. Okay, good. All right. So I know that you have a lot of great things that you offer, like on your website and stuff like that. But before you do that, I want you to tell them a little bit about your program, because I know you actually have a program that you're starting, I think, in April, is it?
I have, yes. And say it's going through beta testing at the moment. Just a second, sir. So my program is called Tapping Away Your Money Blues. And it's an 8-week online program. So I've created loads of great content. So there's a couple of videos to work through each month. So it's for women entrepreneurs. So we have one section, which is about building your business. Then we have a tapping session to do. We do a guided visualization or a guided meditation each week. And then we also have some workbooks as well. And alongside of that, we have a lovely Facebook community. So that is starting on the 4th of April, but I am just starting to open up the VIP wait list. I'm having some trouble with the actual list on MailChimp at the moment. MailChimp's decided not to play games. So if anybody would like to come and join the wait list, then please just send me an email. I will type in my email address here. So it's angel@tanyaangelis.com.
And then I also would like for you to share with them your website, your group, your Facebook group, how they can find you on Facebook.
I will indeed. Yes. So the program, so it's a structured 8-week course. So we start off by looking at healing your money story. So we look at what you regard as your current money story, and just help you to let go of that. And many of the women that I work with are very shy, introverted, or very, very spiritual. So it's helping women to also cope with their spirituality and their sensitivity. We also look at topics like self-sabotage, under-earning, all these kind of things, which are very, very typical for women entrepreneurs to really struggle with. So that is what we're going to be doing. We will be starting with some goodies over in sort of in March time. I'll be sending you out some opportunities to start, you know, diving into some free content. The other things that I do, I'm everywhere. I have a YouTube channel, which is Tapping TV. So if you come and find me on YouTube, so you just type in my name, Tanya Angelis, and you'll find me on YouTube. So there's around a dozen different classes on there, different aspects of EFT, different aspects of your money story. There's an EFT masterclass in there where I go into great detail about the different tapping points, the different emotions that each tapping point goes with. So those are all on there ready for you. I have a free Facebook group, which is called Tapping Away Your Money Blues, which you're all very welcome to come and join. And I also have, I've got my Lily Rose 44444, which is my Twitter handle. And I have also joined Periscope, but I've never actually used it. So I'm not quite sure about that one yet. Where are we? What else do I main social media ones? So would you like me, I will share my Facebook group. So I will just put that one on there for you.
I style modesty. She's trying to listen in, but she doesn't have sound.
Oh no. Oh, okay, so that's my Facebook group on there. So you've got my my Twitter is it's that one. And just trying to think if there's anywhere else that you'll find me on the internet. So there's YouTube, there's Facebook, there's Twitter, and that's about it really. But you know, my actual website, of course. Ha ha. Right. So TanyaAngelis.com is my main website, and then the course, the website to sign up for the wait list. TAYMB.co.uk that's the one the course will be on. So I can say, because the list is playing up a little bit, if you want to come and join the wait list, then please just drop me an email. Just put "I heard your blab" as the subject line for it, and just let me know. And of course, I do my coaching sessions as well. So if anybody would like to come and do some one-to-one coaching with me, I'd be more than happy to do that. So I do 12, 6, and 3 coaching sessions. And as it's in honor of the fact that it's a 2-2-2 day today, normally my three coaching sessions is £244, but as it's a 2-2-2 day, it's £222. But again, just make sure that you send me an email, because you won't find that on the actual website. Send me an email saying "I heard your blab," and that, you know, that is the coaching that you're interested in taking advantage of. So I can send you something then, so we can sort that out.
Awesome.
So I think that covers everywhere. And I'm a member of lots of other different Facebook groups as well. So that's just the one. Those are the ones that I manage. But, you know, you also find me. So I met Takiya through the High Vibe Sistermind Facebook. And there's also lots of different other ones that I'm a member of. So you'll find me everywhere. I'm all over Facebook.
Just type in her name and you'll be able to locate her. And fellas, yep. I just want to say that, you know, in case the fellas do want to work with you as well, that you are okay
with. Oh, yes, yes, yes. I know. As long as they're happy to, as long as they're happy to change, that's all I ask.
All she asks is that you change. I don't think you can ask for more, yeah, right?
And so you've got to be willing to change. That's all I ask. So whether you actually change is your choice, but you have to be willing to go do the change.
So I definitely want to thank you all for tuning in today. Again, my name is Takiya Diamond, and you guys can find me on Facebook at Takiya TK Diamond. Just everything for me, just google Takiya Diamond and you'll find everything. You'll find YouTube, you'll find a bunch of music stuff. I must say that first. You probably gonna find a bunch of songs and music videos and some pretty interesting things from my past. So if you see me in a video all like this, you know, don't judge me. I'm saying, like I said, I'm allowed to turn up, you know. For sure. But you guys have been awesome. This has been an incredible session. If you came in late and you missed any part of this, especially the tapping segment that Tanya did for us today, it's fine. You can press replay. This will be up on YouTube by the end of the night, Eastern Standard Time, obviously. This will be on, maybe within the next hour or two, it should automatically convert over and you guys will be able to just go to my YouTube channel, which is, again, Takiya Diamond, one word, Twitter, Takiya Diamond. My organization is called Minds Up. So if you looking for mind empowerment, mindset coaching, because she does the tapping and I help you tweak your mind to keep your mind on the right path after she's done with you. So with that, and the website for me is actually mindsuplife.com. And you can actually see some testimonials. I have some really wonderful books out. One called Get Your Life Together. Mm-hmm. The other one is Wisdom Words of Consciousness. And you can actually go to my website and get my ebook for free. It's called 7 Things You Need to Change to Change Your Life. So you're going to need that mindset work to keep you aligned, you know, after everything is done. So I would, you know, love to assist you guys going forward after Tanya miraculously helps you heal. That being said, let's just get some music. Let's get some music going on. Y'all know I like to get it pumping when we come in and before we go. We always gotta make some noise, right? So very deep. Enjoy. In your life, you know, just make sure the fireworks stay lit, you know, whatever you got going on, believe in yourself, believe in your dreams, believe in everything that you desire, and remember, you are the creator of your reality, so put your mind to it, get rid of those things that are holding you back, go forward, and spark that flame, guys.
Oh, well, thank you so much for tonight, Takiya. Thank you, everyone. I've loved it all. So I will see you all very soon.
All right, we got to dance out with you.
Oh, you're better at the dancing than I am. Oh, dear. I know. No. Oh. Hey.